Welcome to the In the Church TV and radio broadcast, where we are shining the light of God's Word in the church to discuss and resolve real everyday issues that are taking place around the world, throughout the nation, exposing the good, the bad, and the ugly as we engage in powerful conversations with our expertise, opinions, and revealing everything through the truth of God's Word on every topic imaginable. And so we thank you for joining us in the church on tonight. I am your host, Apostle Deron Shay Dorn, and I'm excited to be with you on tonight in the church. Amen, amen, and amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We just bless God in this place because He is wonderful. He is amazing. And there is no one like Him in the name of Jesus. I am so excited that you are joining us in the church on tonight for a dynamic episode for what God is saying and doing and what He's releasing in the church for such a time as this. And I bless God in this place that you are here with us on tonight. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. As God change our lives, transform our minds. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so I just thank God for each and every one of you in the church on tonight. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Glory, glory, glory to God in this place. In the majestic name of Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory be unto God in this place. We have a dynamic episode on tonight for our listeners. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. We want to deal with the matters and the issues that we need to talk about in the church. We need to deal with as it is affecting many lives around the world, throughout the nation, mentally, emotionally, and psychologically dynamic people of God. And so, yes, it is a very sensitive conversation that we're going to have on tonight, but it's a very real conversation. It is a conversation that it's much needed for such a time as this. Amen. And the time is now, people of God, that we deal with it and that we expose the work of the enemy, the work of the adversary. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory be unto God in this place. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. And so on tonight, our topic, we're going to address, right? We want to address this bill that was released or that took place in New York a while back ago, not too long ago. But you know what? Before we get into this conversation, let us go to the throne of grace. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory, glory, glory be unto God in this place. Amen, amen, and amen. To God be the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, gracious God, we just thank you in this place and we magnify you and we give you glory. We lift your name on high, oh God. Lord, we thank you for coming into this broadcast and having your way, oh God, that you would speak, oh God, to our hearts and that you would speak to our minds, oh God, and that you would saturate, oh God, with your presence in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that you will cause a spiritual awakening in the earth, God, for such a time as this, Almighty King, in the majestic name of Jesus, so that, oh Father, that we would no longer, Lord God, operate under the spirit of abortions around the world, throughout the nation. actions in the name of Jesus. Revive us in this place, oh God. Cause us to be sensitive to your spirit, oh God, and what it is that you're saying in this hour, so that we would no longer be deceived, oh God, by the enemy. That, Lord God, so that we would no longer, oh God, bring wrath, oh God, and arouse you in anger, oh God, because of, oh God, the decisions, oh God, that we're making, or decisions that we are agreeing with. Oh gracious King, help us in this place. Lead us in your truth, so that, oh God, that we may rise up in the truth of your word, and that we will no longer, oh God, settle, oh God, and be comfortable, oh God, against things, oh God, that, oh God, that you are against. Your word says we ought to hate what you hate, and we ought to love what you love, oh God. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, oh Father, we're praying that your people around the world, throughout the nation, will come into a place of spiritual alignment, oh God, with your very word of truth, that we would, Lord God, that we would accept your word in its fullness. Almighty King, in the name of Jesus, no longer, oh God, living in places or operating, oh God, in the partiality of your word, but know, oh God, that we receive the fullness thereof, and that we stand as children of the light, as children of righteousness, that it be known that we are your seed wherever you grace our feet, wherever, oh God, you place us in, oh God, in the various sectors in the world, whether it's in the political, the education, the business, oh God, sector or realm, in music, oh God, or in arts, and Lord God, in media, whatever that it may be, that you send us, oh God, in the family or in the religious sector, oh God, that your word, oh God, will be found in us, and it will be that which illuminate in everything that we do, in the name of Jesus, that we will no longer bow down to Baal. We will no longer conform, oh God, to the ways of society, and Lord God, we will no longer be seduced by our wicked and evilness, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that we will no longer be able to be bribed in the Ikorobasia, and that we will no longer sell out your word of truth, God, but that we will stand, oh God, in the power of your word, and in the authenticness of truth, oh God, in the name of Jesus, so that lives can be saved. Oh, gracious King, hallelujah, Ekorabasaya, oh, mighty King, in this place, have your way, transform, oh God, Lord God, our minds on tonight, in the truth of your word, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we're praying that the church will awaken, that the church will arise, that the church will come out of the closet and stand in the pureness and the truth of your word, oh God. In the name of Jesus, no longer hiding, oh God, hallelujah, no longer hiding, oh God, in the name of Jesus, in falsehood, oh God, but will rise up in the truth of your word, and it will be the evidence, oh God, by the lifestyle that we live, oh, in the name of Jesus, glory be unto your holy and righteous name, oh God, have your way in the church on tonight, touch our hearts, touch our minds, Lord God, renew us in this place, transform us in this place, oh God, so that your word, oh God, will, oh God, begin to transform our lives and those that, oh Lord God, that you have called us, oh God, to be around, the neighbors, oh God, that we are called, oh God, to help and assist, in the name of Jesus, oh God, guide us in your word of truth on tonight, that we may be healed, delivered, set free, that we may, oh God, walk in the truth of your word, in the majestic name of Jesus, have your way, Almighty God, in this place, in Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. To God be the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Dynamic people of God, I want you to definitely do me a favor on tonight. Go ahead and share this broadcast, amen, on your social media platforms. Go ahead and share it, and we are looking forward, amen, glory to God, to what God is going to do in the majestic name of Jesus. We understand that this is a sensitive situation, a sensitive topic, amen, but let us stand up for Christ on tonight. Let us stand up for the truth of God's word on tonight, amen, in the majestic name of Jesus, glory to God, as we deal with the truth, amen, in Jesus' name, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. So we bless God for you, and amen, for everybody that shared this broadcast, amen, and everybody that's listening under the sound of my voice, I just speak a blessing over your life, amen, in the name of Jesus, glory to God. We're going to deal with or talk about over the series over the next couple of weeks. We're going to deal with abortions in the church. We're going to deal with this spirit of abortion that is just running rapidly, amen, glory to God, and the churches and standing up and rising up in the truth of God's word and standing up against the evil and the wickedness that comes behind that operates out of the spirit of abortions, amen, in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. And so we're going to deal with it in very multi-dimensional levels and ways of that nature of people of God, because what I understand and the truth of God's word and what God has been ministering unto me, you know, for years when it deals with abortions, amen, abortions do not start, the thought of abortions, the characteristics of abortion does not start at the moment when a woman is notified of her being pregnant. No, she have aborted many things, not only her, but others have aborted so many things way before that moment of opportunity came along to abort something else. And so we're going to deal with that. It is so easy for one to have a physical abortion when they have been operating under the spirit of abortions all their lives. And it's not just women that's operating under the spirit of abortions, but you also have men that are functioning under the spirit of abortion. And so we're going to talk about it tonight. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And if we can grab the concept of what the spirit of the true living God is saying when we're dealing with this content, when we're dealing with the matter of this thing, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, glory to God, we can put this spirit to death. We can put this spirit to death, people of God, in the name of Jesus, glory to God, hallelujah. I'm just reminded of, amen, the spirit of the Lord just ministering to me about his children, about his beloveds, amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And those that are familiar with my book titled Abortions in the Church, Divine Strategies to Spiritual Deliverance. It surely was birthed in the earth to deal with this specific matter right here. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. And so when God woke me up about this abortions, amen, he began to minister to me about how radical we are when it comes to abortions. He began to talk about how, as Christians, that we are against the murder of a life. Amen. But when it comes to spiritual murders, we are completely silent. We are very radical and vocal when it comes to abortion protesting and rallies and discussions. But even now in these days and times, we even got other believers that are on the other side of the fence. Why? Because of their immoral behaviors that they aborted a long time ago, aborted the morals and the standards of truth that would even lead them and cause them to have the mindset, yes, amen, Lord, it's okay, amen, to abort a life, to abort a child, amen, that God has blessed with. So the abortion characteristic and mindset stems way beyond somebody's thought pattern or conversation that leads to let's abort this child. So we got to dig deeper, amen, on both sides of the coin. You know, on both sides of the coin, amen, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, because neither parties, those that are pro-life and those that are that are not, amen, glory to God, both of their concepts, they need to come into the understanding of why this thing is happening, why, amen, glory to God, people are operating under this, and when they come into an understanding, then all can come into alignment with the truth, amen, of God's word. And so we're going to take some time and some moment today to deal with the partial birth abortions, to talk about it, to deal with what it is, so that we can be even a little bit more informed on that. Amen, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. We may not so much dive into the abortion bill that had taken place, but we're surely going to, over the next series of weeks, we're going to dive into that thing, and we're going to dismantle every lie and deception that has been put in place, or that has been established out of the mindset of those who would even agree with such a bill. Amen, glory to God, that their mindset of abortions just did not start with the formulation of that bill. No, they had already aborted so many moral standards. So it's easy once, amen, glory to God, one of the things that I say about in my book, what makes you a high risk of having an abortion is this: your history. A pattern of abortions can cause an individual to be highly susceptible into continuing to have an abortion, whether it's spiritually so or physically so. Why? Because we become very desensitized, right? Amen, glory to God, when it comes to having them. And so that's why it's so easy. Some people just don't even have a conscience behind it, that they can continue to even have the physical abortions, because spiritually they had already aborted so many different things. One of the things that God spoke to me about abortions, amen, glory to God, was that people, amen, glory to God, he said the physical abortions is just a glimpse. It is just a small glimpse of what's taking place spiritually. And he said, amen, glory to God, when we deal with the spirit of man, when the spirit of man, amen, glory to God, is dealt with, amen, and there's awakening in the spirit of man, and they come into the alignment of truth, and we begin to stand back again and align with standards and morals, amen, glory to God, we will reduce and eliminate the physical abortions, amen, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, glory to God, because it is these abortion of the spiritual things, amen, our morals and things of that nature that will place us in a place, but it's okay for us to have natural abortions, to abort a life. Because we aborted life a long time ago. And we're going to talk about how we abort life. How we cause death. Amen. I'm going to God. Beyond the extension of those that who are pregnant. And having abortions that are taking the life of a child, amen, in the world. So we're going to talk about that today, people of God, and I'm excited about it, amen, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujh. I've been in a place, amen, where I've been wanting to jump on this title for quite some time, but I'm glad for the timing, and we're doing it right here and right now for such a time as this. Amen. Glory to God. So we thank God for the message being heard in this season and in this hour. But what we're going to get ready to do right now, people of God, right here in the church. And again, I thank you so much for sharing this broadcast on your social media platform so that others can get in on this conversation, people of God. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, amen, we are definitely going to deal with what they are saying about partial birth abortion so that we can have definitely begin to build a foundation in which we're going to begin to expose and dismantle the lies and the deceptions of the adversary, dynamic people of God, so that we can surely, maturely, amen, deal with what God is saying in this season and in this hour, amen, in the lives of his people, so that our lives can change, our lives can be rearranged and turned around, and we can align with the word of truth. It is time for the church to stand up, amen, in the name of Jesus. To God be the glory, hallelujah. So we just bless the name of Jesus in this place. We will be right back, dynamic people of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In the church, we're going to take a quick break in Jesus' name.
Oh, Here I am.
Down in glory.
to keep me safe from harm. I will stay close in your loving arms. I promise I will give my all, trusting that you will never let me fall. Over, I pray the things I've done in the past will be pleasing in your sight. Lord, you know I've tried to do what's right. Shout it, glory. I wanna shout.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. We just bless God in this place because he has been good to us. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Glory to God. And so we have to say glory, glory, glory. Glory be unto God in this place in the name of Jesus. I do want to welcome you back to the In the Church TV and radio broadcast. I am your host, Apostle Deronche Zorn with Divine Order Restoration Ministries International, where we are restoring the order of God, one life, one body, one nation at a time. And I'm so privilege and honor for, you know, what God has placed in my belly. Amen. Glory to God. Today we are dealing with a topic of dealing with abortions. We're dealing with the spirit of abortions. This murdering spirit that is rampant within society. Amen. And it is continuing to show it itself. And even as earlier this year, we had a bill passed in New York where individuals can get abortions right up until delivery, people of God. And so we want to deal with the matter and the issues at heart that's going on here. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so we're going to deal with some articles and things of that nature that we've looked at, that we've been exposed to. But like I said, we want to first come and deal with what they're calling post-abortions. Amen. Partial birth abortions. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. So that's what we're going to deal with in this particular segment. Okay. And so partial birth abortions is a procedure in which the abortionist pulls a living baby feet first out of the womb of the birth canal. They pull everything out except for up the head, which then the abortionist purposely keep enlarging just inside of the cervix, the opening of the womb, where they then puncture the base of the baby's skull with a surgical instrument. Then they insert a catheter into the womb and remove the baby's brain with the suctioning machine. And this causes the skull of the baby to collapse, which the abortionist completes the delivery of the now dead baby. So let me do this right here, because some of these terms and what is being revealed behind this partial birth abortions, it is not verbiage or language that is pretty. It is verbal and language that is very gruesome, right? And so I'm just going to, let me just lay it out there. So just advisory on some of the language and the terms and the things that's going on as we paint the picture of what is taking place here. So they have put forth the Partial Birth Abortion Act. So what is that? The Partial Birth Abortion Act. Amen. I'm sorry. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. That's not what it's called, and that's not what I'm going to discuss right now. We want to discuss why is this called partial birth, right? So under our state laws, a live birth occurs when a baby is entirely expelled from the mother and show any signs of life, however briefly, regardless of whether the baby is viable, develop enough to be sustained outside of the womb with neonatal medical assistance, you know, even at 4.5 months. You know, it is said that if a baby is expelled or removed completely from the uterus, that the baby will gasp for breath. And sometimes survive for hours, even though their lung isn't fully developed or sufficient enough to sustain them with their respiratory, right? And so that's why the term partial birth is a great description of this partial birth abortion. And so and that's why when we talked about what it is, we now get a little bit understanding of why they remove the baby and kill the baby in the way in which it is done. Now, partial birth abortions, according to the National Coalition of Abortion Providers, right, it is said that that partial birth abortions are performed 3,000 to 500 times annually, and these numbers are very, very low. They're probably not as accurate as they should be, right? Not as accurate as they should be. It is also mentioned that the vast majority of partial birth abortions are performed within the 5th and the 6th month of pregnancies on healthy babies of healthy mothers. Amen. I'm in the name of Jesus, my God. And so, and then we kind of got the down and dirty, right, of what this partial birth abortion, what it is, amen, glory to God, and how it is performed, and why, we're really not behind the why, the mindset of an individual would perform such an act or would be at the point of birth or delivery and decide that they will abort this child, even from the moment of conception. But again, people of God, I have to just strongly encourage us and put in our mind of understanding that abortion mindset or that spirit of murder did not start when the woman conceived or found out that she was pregnant, right? It did not start there. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. It started way before. And it started with other decisions that was made. So we want to definitely deal with that. I want to for a moment just transition conversation just a little bit so that you can kind of hear the mind and kind of hear the heart behind why I'm so passionate about this and why, right? You're gonna hear a whole lot behind this from me until the voice is being heard, that people are understanding and people are getting into the place and the mindset of knowing, right, what is happening, right, you know, right in our families, you know, right in the house of God as well. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. And so I'm going to be speaking about it from the natural standpoint, but as well as the spiritual standpoint, because what's taking place under this partial birth abortion, it is a clear representation of a glimpse of what is taking place spiritually. You know, people have abortions for many different reasons. But I want to read this insert out of my book. I want to read this insert out of my book to bring the connection of why I'm so passionate and even my understanding of this matter, right? Of this matter and why I am so against this. And the other main reason, because God is against it. He said, I got to hate what he hate. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And he hate murderers. Amen. My God. Oh, he hate murderers. And amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so we're going to deal with some things on today. So here in my book, Abortions in the Church, and I deal with something here in my, I think it's my third title, my third chapter, right? The third chapter in the book. And it deals with spiritual abortions. It still deals with spiritual abortions, but I talk about my physical and spiritual. I talk about it, my experience from a physical standpoint and how it transitioned or at my physical standpoint, but also my spiritual standpoint of abortions as well. This particular section is called Fear Birth My Decision. And I'm going to read it to you as such. It said, once again, I am at one of my favorite places that over the last 8 months happens to be the barrier of bad news for my life. If you haven't figured it out, I'm in my doctor's office for a postpartum visitation after giving birth to a stillborn baby. This doctor visit is not so routine, as I'm here to get checked, discuss my traumatic experiences, and this time go home. Amen. With some form of birth control method, which again is something that I'm very, very against. Birth control methods were something that I would never have considered, as I can give you a thousand of reasons not to use them because I'm a natural type of woman. However, due to fear, my series of unsuccessful pregnancies, the trauma, and to keep me from being committed to a mental institution, this choice had become my only option. especially when my doctor immediately denied my desire to have a hysterectomy. Now that I look back on the emotional desire, I'm glad they didn't listen to my emotions, but considered my future. At this time, we only had our first son, and I couldn't see beyond the pain that was behind the trauma. After this experience, I aborted the birth control route by force for a season and then by choice. Now, we had gone through the traditional route of my doctor visit, and I'm waiting to discuss with my doctor birth control options, right? I'm expecting for him to come in with pamphlets of information, diagrams, and product choices. Instead, he come into the examination room uttering words I did not have the capacity to hear or conceive. He states, "Miss Worthing, you were pregnant." Now, this was either one or two things, a running joke, or he was serious. Oh, how I wished it was a joke, but he was very serious. The room appeared to begin to get smaller, and the oxygen was leaving the room. I almost hyperventilated as I was going into shock behind this news. I could not believe what I was hearing. It's July of 1996, exactly 2 months after giving stillbirth to a son and 8 months from my miscarriage, and he's talking about you are pregnant. Somebody was playing games or trying to mess with my head immediately without any thoughts. Fear led me to utter, I'm having an abortion. Looking back, another emotional decision. I wasn't asking any questions, neither did I care about anyone's opinion. No one had experienced what I had been through and was dealing with at all. Mentally and emotionally in that space, I was a wreck, and I had felt that another unsuccessful pregnancy would push me over the edge. I was afraid of a repeat of past pregnancy failures, and I didn't want to lose my mind. My home life was already being affected by previous unsuccessful pregnancies as the personal pain and anger turned into resentment, anger, bitterness, and so many other things toward my boyfriend. It wasn't fair to me, and my response toward him was horrible at times. I lashed out due to my pain, disappointment, and shame. For the record, I don't believe in abortions, and I never did. However, fear, due to my past traumatic pregnancies, drove the thought and staying to have one. It's amazing how fear would change your belief. I'm sharing this experience to show how the natural realm and the spiritual realm parallel one another. Before I left my doctor's office, I had made the arrangements to carry out with the abortions. I went home. I waited for my boyfriend to get there from work to let him know what we're getting ready to do. I already made his decision, and it wasn't up for discussion. Fear kept a grip on me and controlled a lot of my behaviors. Awaiting my abortion appointment brought on more fear and anxiety than one could ever even begin to imagine. I didn't want people to judge me. So I had to go through this without telling anyone. Neither did I want to hear anyone's opinion. Oh, let me not forget to mention that my grandmother would have killed me about this. Finally, the day came and we were off to drop off our firstborn to make the appointment. And something got in the way. It delayed us for about 5 minutes. And when we arrived to the clinic, we had to reschedule, right? They just had taken a fearful moment of my life. That took a fearful moment of my life and expanded it immediately. And anyway, by the next available appointment, it would have been too late for me to have an early abortion. And my conscience would not allow me to consider having one after 12 weeks. So I took the abortion off the table and decided to continue with this high-risk pregnancy. Beyond this, I didn't know what the aftermath of following through what an abortion feels like, but I know there is a road to recovery, to healing, and deliverance that is needed as one has traveled, for those who have traveled through that experience. Now, only if I would have been that sensitive to the voice and timing of God. Amen. When I was considering and having a spiritual abortion with the assignment that God had placed in my heart. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. As I remember each account and the role of fear, trauma, my environment, my emotions, my history, and so many other things played somehow in each one of them. I do regret and repent for allowing these things to override God's word for my life. And I do not take for granted any opportunities that he has allowed to come back, right, over in my life, to have a chance to redo or to move and birth those specific goals and assignments in my life. So today we're going to travel down my memory lane for a few moments on an event that I experienced as I aborted God's assignment for my life. At the age of 15 and a half, I got the news that changed my course of directions more than I have imagined. I always thought that I would finish school, get married, have a career, and have children. Let me not fail to mention that I wanted to get married before I ever had sex. However, I aborted that concept. I aborted the concept at the age of 14. I aborted my moral standards. And it led me down a road of discovery at the age of 15 and a half. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Of something that I was not ready for. About a month before, my grandmother took us to the doctor's office. My younger sister and I had discovered that I might be pregnant because I had missed my cycle. I could not tell my grandmother this information, so we were going to hide it from her. However, grandmama just being grandmama, I don't know why we had this particular appointment scheduled like right around the corner, but grandmother had set us up a doctor appointment to do our yearly checkups. And I didn't know how to back out of the doctor appointment. We got to the doctor office and they ask all their questions. As the doctor is interviewing me, my grandmother's in the room. So my answers were all the right answers to say in front of your grandmama. The doctor asked, "Are you sexually active?" I responded, "No." I responded, "No." Sighing on the inside, she stated, "Have you ever had sex?" My mind is saying, "Lady, don't keep asking these questions, and especially in front of my grandmother, as my mouth proceed to say, no, ma'am. Then she asked, well, when was your last cycle? I answered last month. Now, I was getting very impatient at this moment because she was asking questions that I just really didn't want to answer. And I really didn't want to keep lying to her and things of that nature. But I knew that I had to be very careful with my response with grandmother being right there. I just wanted the doctor to be quiet so I wouldn't have to keep answering questions that I did not want to answer. Lord, forgive me for the lie, but I did not want to be slapped off the examination table. So she does the physical part of my examination, and she could tell that I had been lying. Finally, my doctor leaves the room, and we're waiting for lab results to come back. I'm sitting on this examination table praying silently, Lord, in the name of Jesus, don't let them find out that I'm pregnant. I'm sweating. I'm nervous because I'm about to die if this lady tell my grandmama that I'm pregnant. There's a knock on the door, and it interrupts my prayer and my thoughts. I'm a nervous wreck, but trying to hold it all together. The door opened, and then my doctors come in and ask my grandmother to leave the room. My heart dropped. Because I knew exactly where this conversation was going to lead us. When my grandmother left the room, my doctor asked me again, had I been sexually active? Very afraid and still lying, I said no. Then she had to break the news that I had a positive pregnancy test results. Then she stated she was going to bring my grandmother back in so we could tell her. I pleaded with the doctor to wait until I can get the nerve to face my death. However, she did not understand my turmoil. What happened to the doctor and patient confidentiality? That's a whole nother story. They called in my grandmother back into the doctor room with us and told her the report. I just held my breath, awaiting for my grandmother to give me a blow that will cause my death. Surprisingly, I didn't get that. Praise your name, Jesus. But the ride home had me on pins and needles. I'm 15 and pregnant. Now, what was I going to do? I was planning in my mind ways to work around this addition in my life. I thought that I could finish school, go to college, and work the rest of my plan out. I was in one of the best schools in Atlanta, Georgia at that time. Amen. I'm glory to God. And I was on my way to success. I was on my way to do great things. And I was on my way. And there was no way I could have made it. However, there was a significant component that I overlooked or was just in denial about that was factors in my plan being successful in the rest of my dreams. Up until this point, I never realized how unconducive my environment was for where I desired to go. Being accepted at this school of performing arts because of my talent to play the violin led me to obtain, you know, what I needed to be able to get back and forth to home successfully from school, because it was all the way across town. And that was various variables in my home life, that even hindered, you know, a lot of my school life, and it affected, you know, even my educational endeavors. But I want to get here to this point, I have a baby that has arrived, right? And he had a father who is diligent in making sure that he had everything that he needed. All is going perfect and all is going well as a new mother. And all of a sudden, I get paperwork in my hand saying, you know, okay, you're going to sign him up for child support. And I'm very perplexed and offended because I thought you put people on child support who did not take care of their children. So I couldn't understand what was going on. So I refused to sign the paper and on putting my boyfriend at that time up for child support. And so I nicely declined everything, you know, and everything. And so it led me to moving out of my grandmother's house. And at the age of 16, amen, moving so much, just moving way beyond my time, advancing and being all grown way before I should have. Why? Because a decision of my morals that I aborted, right, 2 years prior to where I am right now in this conversation or this place in my life. In this place in my life. So, my God. So here I am in a place, right? I'm in a place where I have this child that I have to take care of. I have to be responsible for. The child has to be taken care of. Even though I know I have to go to school, the father is working to make sure that, you know, everything is taken care of. However, we could not afford at that time child support. So I made the decision, okay, I'm just going to stay home and take care of my child. So now I am a teenage mother, a unwed mother, a high school dropout. Now, that storyline is very, very familiar with my family history. So it just kind of broke us or kept us in this generational curse, right? And so here I go again, aborting dreams due to my choice of abandoning my virginity. It have led me down a spiral path of aborting one moral act after the next moral act. Oh, I forgot to mention that I was shacking, right? One moral act, aborting one moral act after the next. I realized that some things began to transpire due to, you know, parental traits, environment conditions, and other things that I just won't even discuss here. But I'm trying to bridge that gap between how we abort spiritual things, and it leads us down a path to be willing to abort things in the physical. And so I aborted my morals of staying pure, staying a virgin, holding fast to the word of God. Amen. Glory to God. For our lives, the standard, the code of conduct. So the moment I aborted that, it led me down the path. Now I've aborted my dreams of being educated, finishing high school, going to college, and things of that nature. I've aborted my dreams of being pure into marriage. I aborted those things and things of that nature. I'm just doing one, making one abortion act after another one. I mentioned earlier, right? Glory to God. It's because we was living together shacking that led me now to the point that I talked about fear birthed my decision to desire to have a physical abortion with our second child. Why? Because now we're shacking and I've been pregnant 3 additional times. So on the, three outside of our live child. So now in this third pregnancy, yeah, now I do want to have an abortion because we just had a miscarriage. We just had a stillborn. But those avenues would have not been optional or wouldn't have even taken place had I stayed true to my moral standards. I stayed true to my moral standards. I wouldn't have begun to experience a downward spiral of the things that I desired to do. There's some things that I professed that I would do. Some things, amen, I'm glory to God, thank you, Jesus, that I had said that I would not participate in. And so that one moment of aborting my moral character, amen, it led me to begin to abort other dreams, goals, desires that I desired to have, right? Because it led me into a condition that continued to cause me to abort my standard, one standard after the next. So I became very desensitized on aborting things. So when I got that fourth pregnancy, I was like, yeah, let's do this. Let's do this, you know, and how the fear behind everything drove me to it. But nevertheless, it became a comfortable decision because of all the abortions that I had taken place prior to the spiritual abortion from aborting my moral character. And so I just begin to think about even, amen, when we deal with individuals who are having physical abortions, how many things that they aborted spiritually that even led them to this thing. Now, of course, I can definitely talk about me all day long. Look at the standard code of moral that I've broken. I talked about staying with a boyfriend, shacking up. That was very immoral. That was an immoral behavior. I was fornicating. Amen. And before we even start shacking up, we was fornicating because we had, you know, we had a baby out of wedlock. God said, do not do, amen, get rid of fornication. We're not supposed to fornicate, right? That's the word of truth. That's the standard of God. Amen, glory to God. And so if we don't live to the standard of God, then, you know, other things just happen in our lives. And he set up those, the boundaries, right, for our protection. It's for our protection. And so, amen, if I wasn't in a place where I was fornicating, shacking up against the word of God, all that against the word of God, I wouldn't have been at that doctor office finding out that I was pregnant, then releasing the word, I'm having an abortion, and making those appointments and things of that nature as well. So I kind of want to just kind of bridge the two so we can kind of get an understanding, right, people of God, on this matter, in this matter, as well. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So that we definitely don't take it lightly. We come in a place of understanding that abortions do not start. I just sit you down my journey. Abortions do not start at the point of a woman finding out that she's pregnant. So we got to deal with the moral characters, behavior, and standards. We got to become, again, a people that stand and live in the Word of God and on the Word of God and be unmovable and unshakable. And then we will begin, we will no longer have laws passed like this abortion bill that took place in New York earlier this year that we've yet to talk about. Well, we're going to deal with it. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I wanted us to just begin to get some foundations of some things and also bring in why I'm so passionate and I'm against partial birth abortions, why I stand against abortions altogether as well. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And also, to give you just a little insight, even of as is written in my book, Abortions in the Church, Divine Strategies of Spiritual Deliverance. And so, and to give you further background of why I stand the way I stand, amen, and why I'm passionate about what I'm passionate about. Glory to God, thank you, Jesus, because I understand we're going to get a little bit deeper in this conversation, even as we deal with the death. We're going to talk about deaths beyond, amen, the baby in the womb of the mother. Amen, glory to God, thank you, Jesus. We got to even deal with all the deaths that we cause when we're not moving in the purpose of God and in the will of God. But you know what? We're going to take a quick break. We're going to take a big quick break because there's so many different things that I so much desire to talk about. That's why I know we're going to have a series of conversations as it deals with this specific topic right here. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. But I will also love to hear your comments about it. I would love to also hear what it is that God's placing your heart as well on this conversation. Amen. Do you agree with it? Do you disagree with it? And all those other great things alike, because we, you know, amen, we're just dealing with the truth of the matter. Amen. Glory to God. Some people gonna like it, gonna be able to understand it. Others gonna hate it. But we bless the name of Jesus anyway. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. So let's just have a conversation about it. You can definitely send us a tweet at In the Church Live, or amen, glory to God. You can send us you can follow us on In the Church Live as well. We'll engage in conversation with you on Facebook and Instagram and In the Church, amen, that we can just have a conversation about this matter. Glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. So we will be right back in the church, amen, in the majestic name of Jesus. And so we give God all glory and we give God all praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We just bless the name of the Lord in this place, in the majestic name of Jesus, because he is the true living God. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Amen. We just bless God for being in the church on tonight. Amen. In the majestic name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Let us go to our break in Jesus' name.
words as you see. You see a reflection, someone smiling, but on the inside you're hurting. Well, don't you know that you're beautiful? It's okay, you can make it another day. Oh, this song, hold your head up and say, this is me, the real me, and that's kind of me. is irreplaceable. His amazing ways.
God,
oh,
God, how
excellent.
Majestic name of Jesus, we thank God for the plan that He has for our very lives. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God for our lives. God has a plan. God has a plan. God has a plan. No matter what, God has a plan. Dynamic people of God, in the name of Jesus, glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. We bless the Lord in this place, in the name of Jesus, glory to God. Amen. So on tonight, we do want to welcome you back to the In the Church TV and radio broadcast. I am your host, Apostle Deronche Thorne. Amen. And we just bless God for being in the church. In the church, we shine the light of God's word on the good, the bad, and the ugly. Exposing, amen, it to the truth of God's word. So we discuss any topic that's imaginable. Nothing is off limits, amen, for us to have a conversation on. We're just here to reveal the truth of God's word in the life of God's people. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God in this place, amen, in the majestic name of Jesus, amen. And we do thank you for sharing this broadcast on your social media platforms so that those that you know can get in on this powerful conversation. Dynamic people of God, amen, in the majestic name of Jesus. God has a plan, amen, in Jesus' name. Glory to God. We're going to have another song just for a moment of worship here. Dynamic people of God. Amen. Amen. And amen. To God be the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom He hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Thank you, Jesus. I am one of the redeemed. Not of any good that I have done or ever will do, I fall short each and every day.
And Lord, I did astray,
but your love for me way back on Calvary paid the price for me.
You kept your hand on me,
yes,
when I tried to break free.
I am redeemed from the hand of my enemy.
Lord, I thank you for sending your
only son,
for saving a wretch like me. You gave me life abundantly.
For my mountain high,
for my mountain high, my valley low,
you've done so much for me. You didn't have to do it, Lord.
Lord, I'm so glad you did.
I am redeemed from the hand of my enemy, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin, according to the riches of his grace. What a mighty God I serve. As I look around, I see blessings overflowing.
New mercy, new grace,
each and every day. So unworthy, Lord, to even speak your name.
Love that overwhelmed me. You died and rose to save a sinner like me.
I am redeemed from the hand of my enemy.
Lord, I thank you for sending your
only son,
for saving a wretch like me. You gave me life abundantly.
For my mountain high,
my valley low,
you've done so much for me. You didn't have to do it, Lord.
Lord, I'm so glad you did.
I am redeemed from the hand of my enemy. Psalms 107, verse 2. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of my enemy. I've been given
because of the blood.
No rock will cry out in my
place. Let the redeeming say,
hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. We just bless the name of Jesus in this place. Look, that no rocks, I'm going to say, no rocks will cry out in my place. Amen. We're going to, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. We're going to glorify God. We're going to worship God. We're going to praise God. Amen. In spirit and in truth. In the majestic name of Jesus. Glory be unto the one and only true living God. Amen. In the majestic name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We just bless God. We bless him. We praise him. We magnify him. We glorify him. Amen. Because he is worthy of our praise. Again, we do want to thank you and welcome you back to the In the Church TV and radio broadcast. I am your host, Apostle Deron Shay Zorn. Amen. With Divine Order Restoration Ministries International, where we are restoring the order of God, one life, one body, one nation at a time, here in the church. Hallelujah. In the TV and radio broadcast, we are here to shine the light of God's word in the church, to discuss and resolve real everyday issues that are taking place around the world, exposing the good, the bad, and the ugly. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Glory to God. And so we thank you, amen, for connecting with us on our social media platforms, on Twitter, In the Church Live, on Facebook and Instagram at In the Church. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. And so today we are talking about abortions in the church, and we are just dealing with some information that is out here, that is things that are going on that are causing abortions. That abortion spirit ramping, running around rampantly in the church, right? Not in the church, in the world. And the church is playing a part of that as well. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. And so, people of God, we just dealt with, in our previous segment, we was dealing with, amen, glory to God, partial birth abortions. Amen. That's what we were dealing with, partial birth abortions. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. It's one of the things that we dealt with. Amen. We're just building foundation on what we're going to release. We also talked about a segment in my book titled Abortions in the Church, Divine Strategies to Spiritual Deliverance as well. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Now, we know in the Word, there are just several places in the Word that tells us, people of God, do not kill. Exodus chapter 23, verse 7 says, do not kill the innocent. That's what it says. Deuteronomy 27 and 25 says, curse is the one who takes a bribe to slay an innocent person. Oh, help us, Jesus, in this place. My God, help us in this place. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So, not only, you know, those who make the decision that I'm going to have an abortion, you know, God, anger is aroused at that, but also for those who perform the abortions. It said, curse is the one who takes a bribe, who take money to slay an innocent person. That fetus, that baby there is innocent. It's innocent. Now, here in Exodus chapter 21, verse 22 through 5. Let's have some conversation about this particular word here. And again, this is just part one. We have a lot of ground to cover as we deal with the spirit of abortion and how it's running rapidly and how it's showing itself up in the physical formats. Amen. We ain't even really dealt with formats outside of a woman having an abortion. There's other formats and places that is just showing up and trying and making itself relevant, and people of God, is we got to shut it down. We have to shut it down, and we're the only ones that's going to be able to kill this spirit that is causing death, throughout the world. Also, so here we go in Exodus 21, verse 22. It said, if men fight and hurt a woman with child, so that she gives birth prematurely, yet no harm follows, he shall surely be punished according as the woman's husband imposes on him, and he shall pay as the judge determines. But if any harm follows, then you shall give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, stripe for stripe. Ooh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. So, amen. We're just looking at, we just want God's word to be the foundation on which we form this conversation about how God is against abortions. Amen. Physical abortions, but also spiritual abortions. And when we won't really dive a whole lot into spiritual abortions, I gave you a little insight on how the two parallel as I talked about my own personal life, spiritually aborting things that led to the whole thought process of me wanting to even do a physical abortion, and which abortions has always been a moral standard that I have been against. I've always been against abortions. That's always been my moral standard, code of conduct, right? But I told you how spiritual and how the spiritual abortions affect your mindset even, or your thought, or what you do in the physical, in your life as well. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Now, we can look at Exodus chapter 21 and as being the first law put in place as it concerns fetal homicide, as it concerns a child being harmed doing a separate assault. And I want to deal with this as well. And we'll definitely come back and re-deal with this as we deal with the law, the bill that have been placed, put in place in New York, or that has been passed. And my Jesus, I was looking at some of the things and I said, Lord, we gotta be helped in this place. Amen. Glory to God. But I won't deal with the law. I want you guys to go and look at it, search it out, so that we can have conversation about it. I believe next week as well, I'll open up the lines. I'll open up the broadcast lines as well, so people can call in, so they can give their opinions, their thoughts on this conversation as well. Because again, it's going to go over a series of weeks as we break down. As we break this thing down, amen, in the majestic name of Jesus, glory to God, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, glory to God. So, we were dealing with, amen, I wanted to make sure I give us some scriptures, how God feels and what God says about the life of a child. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hurting of feet, of fetus, right? Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So let's talk about, when does life begin? The life of a baby begins way before the child is born. A new individual human being, being life existence begins at fertilization, when the sperm and the egg forms into a single cell. Right? Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And so that's where birth or life begins, right? Right at that conception. Life begins at conception, right? My God, bless your name, Jesus. And in the United States, over 40 million unborn babies have been killed in the last 29 years. Amen. The 29 years since abortion was legalized, and more than 1.3 million are killed each year. God, help us in this place, because we need Jesus. God is the only person that could help us, right? That can help us with this, people of God. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. But we got to come into a place in our lives where, people of God, that we stop aborting things spiritually so that it will no longer manifest or run over in our lives from the physical. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. And so, we're gonna bless God, and we're gonna thank God, because we're gonna begin to change our mindset. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. Amen. As we know that God is against the murder of life. God is against Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Death. Amen. That we cause among one another. So let me just have a little conversation on tonight before we leave to talk about spiritual abortion, so that we can kind of get an idea of what it is. Because so, tonight is just to set the ground or the tone of what our next couple of weeks is going to look like. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. So, a spiritual abortion. Spiritual abortions is simply this. It's not simple, but this is what it is. Dynamic. Amen. This is what it is, dynamic people of God. So let us just talk about it just briefly. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just want to deal with it. So this is what spiritual abortion is. So it is, amen, hallelujah. Spiritual abortion is defined as the termination of a God given assignment, vision, goal, desire, your purpose, your aspirations, whether it's induced or spontaneous, by the recipient of God's word. Amen. It is the result of an individual not completing or carrying out God's assignment for their life. Amen. So what causes spiritual abortions to take place in the life of an individual, right? an individual receives the word of God, that amen, glory to God, they receive the word of God, and they can find themselves, look, actively engaged and excited about what God has spoken, but something take place that caused them to abruptly or gradually terminate their assignment or give up on their dreams or their hopes, right? And so they abort the word. And so usually things that causes us to abort have spiritual abortions, right? It could take place in our lives when we have we're in environments that are unsupportive, when we're around people that do not support our dreams, our goals, our desires. It can take place when we're around people that don't operate even at the level of faith that we operate in, or the level of belief that we will operate in. That's why the word tells us that that bad company can corrupt, right, good morals. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. And so when you have, when you're in the presence of those, or in the company of those whose morals don't line up with yours, sometimes we can find ourselves in a place where we abort our morals. I spoke earlier about how I aborted my morals and how it led me down a spiral path of aborting another moral after another moral after another moral that led to a physical manifestation of an abortion getting ready to take place, right? Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So, bad, amen, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. So, bad company can definitely corrupt good morals. So, these abortions can take place because of our past or present situations, our peers, society, or environmental influences, right? Our personal, thoughts that we may have about ourselves as well. And then these things can cause these two type abortions. I talked about induced spiritual abortion as well as spontaneous spiritual abortions. And these type of abortions are also natural abortions. People, it is in documented in medical terminology, induced abortions as well as spontaneous abortions. Amen. I'm glory to God. So an induced abortion takes place when an individual is influenced, persuaded, encouraged, provoked, or suggested continuously to abort their assignment, and the individual finally agrees or conforms to these influences or persuasions that have taken place, right? They you know, and it, again, it's produced out of negative environment of people with lack of support, mockery, ridicule, rejection, and things of that nature, or influencing factors that causes an induced abortion. It causes one to become disengaged from their assignment due to the lack of support. You also have those spontaneous spiritual abortion takes place when an individual is made to terminate their assignment unexpectedly, amen, due to situations and circumstances that's beyond the carrier's capacity to carry out the word. Now, it could be a situation or circumstances that happens, and it causes an impulsive emotional behavior or reaction to just abort, what it is that God has called forth in their lives. And sometimes we go through things in life where we're exposed to traumatic events that will just cause us to shut down, give up on the word that God has called forth in our lives. Amen. In the majestic name of Jesus. So we definitely have to be very, very careful. Very, very careful, people of God. So that individuals. So that individuals will not, cause us to abort what it is that God has called forth in our life, whether it is a spiritual induced abortion or a spontaneous spiritual abortion. Amen. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. Next week, people of God, we are definitely going to deal with this New York abortion bill that was passed earlier in January, right? Amen, glory to God. We're going to deal with it and just talk about it and deal with the coincide of it with having spiritual abortions. I just gave you a little insight on what spiritual abortion is, what can cause it to take place as well, dynamic people of God. And we'll go even just a little bit more into what God had led me to write about abortions in the church as well next week. But we definitely want to deal with this bill. We want to paint the picture. I want to show you how the decision to abort, to have an abortion, is way beyond that moment of a woman or making that decision or following through with a decision to have a physical abortion. Amen. In the name of Jesus. So we want to get abortions eliminated or ceased from the spiritual aspect, so it would not lead them to a journey or a role to a natural abortion, in Jesus' name. So on tonight, people of God, I do want to thank you so much for joining us in the church TV and radio broadcast. I look forward to continuing this conversation with you next week in the church. Amen. Get those that you know to come in and engage with us in the conversation. Also, we can further this discussion on our social media platforms. Instagram, Facebook, hit me up at inthechurch.com on Twitter. You can follow me and we can have conversation at In the Church Live. In the church live. Amen. Glory to God. Let's get this conversation even beyond the radio platform. Let's get it on our social media platforms as well and things of that nature, and begin to have dialogue about it and begin to deal with truth so that, you know what, lives can be saved, because there's a whole other side of this abortion, people of God, that we're really going to dig into over the next couple of weeks. It's going to be an eye-opener or a mind-blowing fact that is taking place that we have no clue on what's taking place. But I look forward to meeting you next week in the church. Amen. In the majestic name of Jesus. And so with that being said, dynamic people of God, amen, we are exposing, shining the light of God's word on abortions. Amen. And we will join you, or we want to thank you for joining us, for meeting us back here in the church next week for another dynamic episode. But until then, we're going to go in the love, joy, peace, favor, and the anointing of our most holy Savior, who is none other than Jesus Christ. And it is in his most holy and majestic name that we've convened in the church. Amen. In Jesus' name. To God be the absolute glory. Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.